Branson and Bezos personally experienced the thrill of suborbital flight, the chronicle of two historic days. Two flights that marked the beginning of an era, that of space travel for fun. What future do they have and how much do they cost? Can something truly useful be made out of them for all of humanity and not remain a game for the rich? July 2021 will be remembered as the month that ushered in the era of tourist space travel. The Virgin Galactic and Blue Origin companies blossomed this new form of tourism by sending their respective founders into space. Sir Richard Branson on July 11th and Jeff Bezos on July 20th. Beyond the two events that were concrete but also can be described as ceremonial, what will be the future of these trips for wealthy tourists who choose to experience a 10-minute vacation in space? Sending people into space who don't have any kind of prior experience about flying in general or who don't come from flight-trained military corps is not something that can be done with a snap of the fingers. In fact, Richard Branson's Virgin Galactic and Jeff Bezos' Blue Origin were founded roughly 20 years ago. Virgin Galactic was born in 2004, although its space ancestry stems from the space company founded in 2005, also by Branson, and then fully absorbed by Virgin Galactic in 2012. Blue Origin is even older. Jeff Bezos brought it into existence in 2000, 6 years after Amazon. Both have been working behind the scenes developing their own suborbital flight systems and having mostly or even space tourists travel in mind. Blue Origin came out of the closet and showed itself to the general public in 2009 after receiving $3.7 million from NASA for its Commercial Crew program, aimed at facilitating the development of a commercial space transportation platform for the United States to gain reliable and affordable access to and from the International Space Station, and also for activities in low Earth orbit. Unfortunately for Bezos, NASA then chose Boeing and Elon Musk's SpaceX capsules to follow up on the program. Blue Origin then got a taste of something else related to space other than space tourism, but it was also able to exploit that for its suborbital flight recipe, and that is completely different from Virgin Galactic's. But let's come to the chronicle of these two memorable days. On July 11th, Branson and the five crew members were taken into the skies over New Mexico by the VMS Eve aircraft, which for Virgin Galactic voyages acts as the mothership that releases the space plane, which then completes the actual suborbital flight. Branson and the other five crew members were aboard the latter, the VSS Unity. The parent aircraft reached an altitude of about 14 kilometers when, at a speed of Mach 0.5, it unlocked the VSS Unity space plane, which fired its hybrid propellant engine. After about 2 minutes and 40 seconds at a top speed of Mach 3.1, VSS Unity touched down at its apogee at an altitude of about 86.1 kilometers, and then began its descent. Just before reaching apogee, VSS Unity rotated the wings and both tails, a phase that in jargon is called feathering, to give stability to the aircraft and break the descent, which ended happily with the landing at Spaceport America in New Mexico. Inside the cabin of the VSS Unity, billionaire Sir Richard Branson, 70, owner of Virgin Galactic, at an altitude of 86 kilometers, said in a video transmitted to the ground, "Once I was a child with a dream looking at the stars. Now I'm an adult in a spaceship looking down on our beautiful Earth. To the next generation of dreamers, if we can do this, imagine what you can do." Next, he and the rest of the crew experienced a few minutes of microgravity before the space plane began its re-entry glide. Once on the ground, Branson received astronaut wings manufactured by Virgin from retired Canadian astronaut Chris Hadfield. The official Federal Aviation Administration pins, which are given only to those who have been in space, will be given at a later date. But has Branson been to space? Yes or no? Beyond the importance of the mission for taking a crew of six on a suborbital flight, the event gained interest precisely because of the presence of Branson, who anticipated Bezos in the challenge of the first wealthy owner of a space company to fly in space. Branson reached an altitude of 86.1 kilometers, just beyond the mesopause set at 85 kilometers. The Fédération Aéronautique Internationale, FAI, which deals with standards and records in astronautics and aeronautics, defines the beginning of space as crossing the imaginary Kármán line set at 100-kilometer altitude. But the Federal Aviation Administration, the U.S. Air Force, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, and part of NASA indicate 80 kilometers as the boundary. In fact, the Air Force grants astronaut wings to pilots who exceed this altitude. For the United States, therefore, Sir Richard Branson has been to space. Virgin Galactic reported that it expects at least two more test flights of the space plane in the coming months before beginning regular commercial operation in 2022. Virgin Galactic also reported that 600 aspiring private astronauts have already booked a suborbital flight at the price of about $250,000 per ticket. Among them are famous faces from the star system such as Tom Hanks, Justin Bieber, and Lady Gaga. In short, there is a wait to get in line, although fortunately it seems that at full capacity, Virgin Galactic will be able to make more than 400 launches per year. Hang on a sec, guys, before we continue. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell, you will help us to make products of even higher quality. Jeff Bezos' approach to space has been completely different. The Amazon founder took off on July 20th, the date of the first lunar landing, from a launch pad in Texas on a rocket with a capsule on top hosting the four space tourists. The launch system is called New Shepard, in honor of Alan Shepard, the first American in suborbital space, and is an 18-meter-tall booster that is also capable of landing vertically for reuse. Once undocked from the rocket, the capsule continues its long parabola up to 100-kilometer altitude to cheer its passengers with a breathtaking view of the Earth. Reaching the apex of the parabola arc, the capsule then gently lands thanks to the opening of three parachutes at around 2,000 meters. The suborbital journey of Tuesday, July 20th, was also Blue Origin's first manned flight after 15 test flights without anyone on board, all of which were perfectly successful apart from the first. In fact, Bezos took off with three fellow passengers, Bezos' brother Mark, 82-year-old former aviator Wally Funk, and 18-year-old Oliver Damien, the first paying tourist in Blue Origin history. The New Shepard system's rocket, with the capsule occupied by the four space tourists atop it, departed about 8 minutes late due to a mission check that occurred 15 minutes into the launch when the four were already on board. Commentators on the flight, however, were not overly concerned, since there were no times or rendezvous in space to be met, and they also had favorable weather on their side. There was no problem in doing additional sensor-driven checks. In fact, the mission countdown continued smoothly after the 8-minute break. The rocket, powered by the BE-3 oxygen and liquid hydrogen engine, lifted off from the ramp at Blue Origin Site 1 in West Texas. It should be noted that only the tourists were inside the capsule atop the module, as the New Shepard's journey is fully automated and does not require the presence of pilots or engineers. Of course, the system has its own safety systems. In fact, the capsule can separate from the rocket in case of problems, and it can't even land without a parachute. There is also an escape plan, even in space, using a special engine that can lead the capsule on a course that will bring it back to Earth. After 1 minute of flight, the rocket was already at an altitude of about 7.5 kilometers. After 2 minutes and 20 seconds, the rocket engine was shut down and the separation of rocket and capsule took place at the expected altitude of about 75 kilometers. 4 minutes after launch, the now separated capsule reached its apogee at 170 kilometers, then prepared for the long downward parabola. In the meantime, the carrier rocket also continued beyond the imaginary Kármán line and prepared for a successful vertical landing about 7.5 minutes after launch. The booster, reusable, had already flown two other times before this mission. In the capsule, Jeff and Mark Bezos, Wally Funk and young Oliver Damien were able to experience weightlessness for about 4 minutes while enjoying the landscape of the Earth as seen from an altitude of more than 100 kilometers. At an altitude of less than 2 kilometers, the descending capsule opened the three parachutes that accompanied it over the Texas desert floor. A few meters above the ground, the expulsion of strong jets of air brought the descent speed to about 5 kilometers per hour, and the module with the four tourists landed safely a few seconds later. Blue Origin technicians came and approached the capsule, connecting it to the ground with a cable to discharge the static electricity generated by the module travel. A few minutes later, Jeff Bezos was the first to exit the New Shepard wearing a flashy cowboy hat. He was followed by his brother Mark and Oliver Damien and Wally Funk. All four space tourists can be called astronauts, Because they exceeded not only the 80-kilometer altitude set by the American flight authorities, but also the Kármán line set at 100 kilometers, chosen by the Fédération Aéronautique Internationale for the determination of any flight that can be defined as space. The celebrations obviously ended with champagne. After a mutual exchange of good wishes and compliments, Sir Richard Branson and Jeff Bezos wanted to emphasize that there had never been any rivalry between them. Bezos said, "This is not a competition. This is about building a road to space so that future generations can do amazing things." Yet when Jeff Bezos announced on June 7th that he would be going into space on July 20th with his brother Mark, Sir Richard Branson made sure to find a seat on his VSS Unity, whose departure was already scheduled for July 11th. The two tourist flights offer similar but different experiences, and already this would help the two companies to avoid a war. Even the price could be a discriminating factor, but according to some rumors, the cost of Blue Origin's flight for a single tourist will not be far from the €250,000 asked by Virgin Galactic. There are also other potential competitors in this field, but they are far behind Branson and Bezos. There is Exos Aerospace, formerly known as Armadillo Aerospace, which, however, has shown little substance. There is Masten Space System, which, however, seems more focused on the contract with NASA to send a lander to the moon in 2022. And of course, we cannot fail to mention Elon Musk's SpaceX, which has the potential to do better than both Virgin Galactic and Blue Origin. Even though it has launched itself into space exploration, Musk's company has not given up on space tourism. SpaceX has in fact announced the launch of Inspiration 4, which will be the first mission in the world to bring a crew consisting entirely of civilians into Earth orbit. Inspiration 4 will leave Earth in mid-September, launch from the historic Launch Complex 39A at Kennedy Space Center, and will travel for 3 days on an Earth orbit at an altitude of about 500 kilometers. The capsule that will house the mission crew is a modified Crew Dragon. Instead of the tip, which is usually used for docking to the space station, was in fact installed a panoramic dome and a toilet. To command the mission and to pay the ticket for himself and three other tourists will be Jared Isaacman, an American billionaire expert pilot and holder of several world records of flight. Of course, the crew will receive from SpaceX all the necessary training for a safe flight, including information about the Falcon 9 launch vehicle, the Crew Dragon capsule, the conditions of microgravity, zero gravity, and other forms of stress to which they will be subjected during the trip. This will be followed by emergency preparedness training, exercises in and out of the suits and spacecraft, and mission simulations. At the end of the mission, Crew Dragon will re-enter Earth's atmosphere for a landing near the coast of Florida. There will truly be fun to be had.